The goal of this video is to go through two more examples of a continuous function preserving a topological property about the domain. So in particular, we will prove these two statements. Given some continuous function f, we will first prove with a direct proof that if the domain is path connected, then the image f of a is also path connected. If you have seen the video where I prove that a continuous function on a compact set has compact image, in fact, I proved it two different ways, the flow of this proof will mirror what we did in that video. And then a related notion, which will be proved differently, is that if f is continuous and a is connected, then f of a is connected. All right, so that's what we're going to do, is prove each of these one at a time. So I want you to be ready for these proofs. What I want you to do is pause and make sure that you have revisited the definition of a path-connected set and revisited the definition of a connected set. So we will prove that both of these images, f of a, satisfy the definition of a path-connected set and satisfy the definition of a connected set. So to proceed in that way will require us to be familiar with those definitions. Just like we did when we proved the analogous statement for compact domains, let's begin by sketching a picture of how the argument must proceed. So imagine that we have a domain which is path-connected. So here is my domain A. It is the domain of a continuous function f. What we would like to do is show that the image f of A satisfies the definition of a path-connected set. Now, a moment ago, I asked you to revisit that definition if you don't have it committed to memory yet. What we want to do is claim that for any pair of points in f of a, so say y1 and y2, there exists a continuous path between them. This is where we must start our proof because it mirrors the first clause in the definition of being a path-connected set. What we are going to do is basically bring these outputs back to the domain by looking at their pre-images. So back in the domain, we will identify an x2. F of x1 is y1 and f of x2 is y2. This choice here is not necessarily unique because perhaps 10 inputs get mapped to y1. That's okay. The pre-image of y1 may consist of more than one point, but we will just pick one point. All right, and then we use the hypotheses that we were given in this statement. A is path connected, so there will be a path from x1 to x2. F is continuous. I want to evaluate f along this path. In other words, we are going to do a composition of continuous functions, f of the parametrization that describes this path, and that will generate a path in f of A, which will go from y1 to y2, if this one went from x1 to x2, and which will be continuous. So we will meet the definition of path connectivity for f of a. It's not a very long proof. And in fact, I think I just did the whole thing out loud with this picture. So if you're feeling confident and like you understand what's going on here, go ahead and pause and see if you can write out what we just discussed out loud. Then I will come back and write out the full proof. All right, it's not a very big proof, so I think we have enough room to write out the proof in full detail. Suppose y1 and y2 are outputs in the range of this function f of a. Choose inputs x1 and x2 from a, which get mapped there. Since A is path connected, so I'll write path connected, abbreviated like that. We know that there exists a continuous parametrizable path from x1 to x2, which lives in A. So there exists a continuous path. Let me write it here. Phi, taking us from the unit interval, that's like the domain for the parameter, phi of t, if you will, to A with phi of 0 equal to x1. And phi of 1 equal to x2. When I write this notation here, I mean that the domain of the parameter goes from 0 to 1. And by saying it maps to A, we're saying the path lives in A. Okay, we have that path I sketched in the domain when we looked at the illustration of this proof. Take a moment if you haven't worked through this argument on paper yet to pause and see what happens when you look at the composition f of phi. So where does that live and how does it behave? We have everything we need to finish this proof. Since the composition of continuous functions is continuous, when I do f of phi, I'm creating a map from the unit interval to A to f of A. Since the composition of continuous functions is continuous, this composition is continuous. And notice that f of phi of 0 is really like f of x1, which is y1. And similarly, f of phi of 1 is f of x2, which is y2. That's exactly what we need in order to justify that f of A is a path-connected set. We have a continuous map from this unit parameter space to f of A, it lives in f of A, which connects y1 and y2. So thus, A is path connected. It's a little easier than the proof that a continuous function on a compact set has compact image, but it really follows the same thought process. So it might be fun to compare this to the two proofs that we did already. Next, we will prove that a continuous function on a connected set has connected image. And that proof will actually look a little different, and try to anticipate why. So if you haven't had a chance to do so, look at the definition of a connected set and kind of see like what's different about it. I said this proof would go a little differently, and here's why. When we define the notion of a connected set, we defined it by stating what it is not. So we gave like a full definition for the idea of being able to separate a set, and then we said that A is connected if it cannot be separated. So it's defined indirectly, so it shouldn't surprise you that this proof will be an indirect proof. Namely, we are going to prove it by proving the contrapositive. So the contrapositive would be if f of A is not connected, then A is not connected. Or in other words, if f of A can be separated, then A could be separated. So let me write out that that's what we will show. So we will show that if f of A can be separated, then A can be separated. So that's what the contrapositive of the statement is. All right, if we're going to assume that f of A can be separated, then that means that we can write it as covered by two open sets, which both cover f of A, but which are disjoint within f of A. Okay, so let me write out that definition. It's going to look just like the definition that we covered when we looked at separated and connected sets. Suppose There are open sets U and V. Satisfying four conditions. I'm going to write them here. The first one is that U and V together cover F of A. So let me say F of A is a subset of the union of these two sets. Then my second and third conditions are going to say both of them actively contribute to this cover. So it's not like F is entirely covered by U and V is off somewhere else. So F of A intersect U is non-empty. So F of A is at least in part covered by U, but also it's being partly covered by V. So both of these open sets contribute to the open cover of F of A, and they do not overlap. At least not over F of A. So what we'll say is U intersect V is empty, in particular when we look at how they intersect within the set F of A. Okay, so let me make sure I've stated all four of these correctly. So F of A is being covered by their union. Each one is contributing to the cover, and within F of A, they do not overlap. Okay, this looks right. This is what we are assuming about the image F of A. Now we're going to use the continuity of F to map backwards to the domain. So in particular, when we look at the topological description of continuity, that pre-images of open sets are open relative to the domain, that will allow us to basically associate to each of U and V an open neighborhood back in the starting metric space. Okay, so by the topo characterization of continuity, a lot of long words in this phrase, so I'm saying by the topological characterization of continuity, there exist open sets. Keep going with abbreviation here, but I hate seeing that standalone in the middle of a sentence, but let me keep going. We are going to pull U and V back to, I'm going to name them U tilde and V tilde. So there exist open sets U tilde and V tilde so that the preimages of U and V can be written as the intersection of these open sets and the domain A. All right. If I now try to write out the four characterizations, I'm going to run out of room very quickly. So what I would like to do is discuss what will happen with U tilde, V tilde, and A back in the domain, just writing it to the right here. Before I do that, though, let me have you pause and see what you can conclude. So I'm giving you U tilde and V tilde. It should be the case, if this proof is on the right track, that these are going to separate A. So you want to check if these four conditions are going to be satisfied with U tilde, V tilde, and A. Given my space limitations, the rest of this proof is going to be mostly out loud, but I'll write the statements here. So we want to verify that U tilde and V tilde separate A. So the first thing to check is A contained in the union of U tilde and V tilde? And this must be true because if there's some point X which is not being covered by U tilde or V tilde, then F of X would not be be covered by their images. So F of X would be a point in F of A not covered by U or V. So this is true. The rest of it follows pretty similarly. Let's see, what's the analogous statement? A intersect U tilde is non-empty. In other words, if everything lived in V, then all outputs, V tilde. That's the trickiest thing about this is remembering to say tilde. If every input in A actually lived in V tilde, then all outputs would live in V, which would mean that this intersection was empty. And following the same train of thought, we can immediately write down that A intersect V tilde is also empty. Do these overlap in the domain? Or is it the case that U tilde intersect V tilde intersect A is empty? Once again, thinking about inputs and where they would map to, if there was an input in A, which was covered by both of these, so it lived simultaneously in U tilde and V tilde, then its output F of X would be covered by both U and V while being an output. So if this was non-empty, this would be non-empty. So that's the argument. You might want to write down a little bit more detail than what I've written here. But at this point, I think we are basically done. So this wraps up the proof that if A is connected and F is continuous, F of A is connected. We've seen now that being compact is preserved by a continuous function, as is being path connected or connected. If you haven't had a chance to think through this yet, I'm going to go ahead and tell you that being open and closed, these are not preserved. So a continuous function on an open domain does not necessarily have an open image. And similarly, a continuous function on a closed domain does not necessarily have a closed image. I won't go into that more in this video, but you're welcome to think through why that's not the case.